Hello everyone. Today I am going to discuss about disaccharides. So disaccharides are nothing but these are the carbohydrate biomolecules which are necessary for the all living cells. So disaccharides are nothing but these are the carbohydrate biomolecules. These carbohydrate biomolecules, the last previous classes we discussed about monocarbohydrates and their functional advantages and their stereoisomerism and their projection formulas, that is Fischer and Howard formulas. Today we are going to discuss about the disaccharides. Exclusive, this class is only for the disaccharides, because we need to learn many things in a disaccharides, right? Let's begin this. So disaccharides are nothing but the name itself indicates. Disaccharides are the combination of two monosaccharide subunits. So you should understand, the combination of two monosaccharide subunits, we call them as a disaccharides. There is a condition whether these two monosaccharide subunits, these are maybe the similar or may not be the similar, right? You should remember, what do you mean by di? Di is a very simple, that is to be two. What is two? Two monosaccharide subunits will join together and will form the disaccharide. So when any carbohydrate that is forming to the disaccharide, there will be two possibilities. Maybe the monosaccharide subunits are maybe similar or maybe dissimilar. So you should remember that disaccharides are nothing but the connecting of the two monosaccharide units, whether it, which is same or maybe dissimilar. Then there is an important thing we should understand, that when the two monosaccharide subunits, when two monosaccharide subunits are connecting each other, then what is the connecting link? This we should understand. The connecting link is nothing but this is, we call them as an O-glycosidic bond, right? And simple, we call them as a glycosidic bond. Glycosidic bond is the bond which can connect to the two monosaccharides. That is very important, right? Then if you see the properties of the disaccharides. So when you take the disaccharide, the most of the disaccharide will follow these properties. One thing, they are in crystalline nature. Definitely crystalline nature means they are should be like in sugar crystals, right? Most of the disaccharides are water soluble because they are having the hydroxyl group, many OH groups. That we call them as a many hydroxyl groups, and obviously these are to be sweet to taste, right? These are the three basic properties that should be attributed to this disaccharides. So as I said, so the connecting link between two monosaccharides is glycosidic bond. So this slide is exclusive for how the glycosidic bond is forming. This is very important. You should be remember how it is to be forming, right? When a hydroxyl group mean that is nothing but OH group of one sugar, that is nothing but one monosaccharide, react with the anomeric carbon of the other monosaccharide, right? You should remember this. So for suppose, if you take here two glucose molecules, whatever I have written is this is one glucose molecule and this is another glucose molecule. So if you are taking these two glucose molecule, so what is the numbering? Numbering will be like this: 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons, right? This is the first carbon position. And if you take the next glucose, where the number is same like the first one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, right? So here you should remember that first glucose at the first carbon hydroxylic group and the second carbon and the second glucose of the fourth carbon hydroxylic group. These two things will join together and will release the water molecule. So we call them as the bond formation. You just see here. We call them as this is O-glycosidic bond, which is very essential, right? So now initially these are two monosaccharide subunits, and after this glycosidic bond formation, they became a disaccharide with the releasing of water molecule. These type of glycosidic bond formation, we generally call them as condensation reactions, right? So condensation reaction is nothing but where water molecule will be released and the bonding, glycosidic bonding will be formed in between two monosaccharide subunits. And if we want to break this bond, then that type of reaction we call them as an hydrolytic reaction or hydrolytic reactions. What do you mean by hydrolytic reactions? Where we will use the water molecule and we will break this glycosidic bond, and again it will form the reverse reaction, that is two monosaccharide subunits, right? This is to be very important. You just remember that this is O glycosidic bond that should be present in two monosaccharide subunits. And there is a question. First, suppose if a polysaccharide is having 100 monosaccharide subunits, then can you tell me the how many number of O glycosidic bonds that should be present? Right? Is it clear? So for suppose if you are taking a polysaccharide, that polysaccharide will have the 100 monosaccharide subunits, and can you predict how many number of glycosidic bonds that can be present? Most of the people will say it is 100, but it's not, right? Always glycosidic bond bond formula will be n minus 1. N is nothing but number of monosaccharide subunits. Here the initial, as I given the example where monosaccharide subunits are 100. So n equal to 100 minus 1, which is 99. So 99 glycosidic bonds that can be present in a polysaccharide which consisting of 100 monosaccharide subunit. You just remember, this is a very simple formula, and many entrances you will get this kind of the formulas. Now we move on to the classification of disaccharide, which is very important. So what do you mean by classification? If you remember the definition of the carbohydrate, what is the definition? Compounds which have their functional group either aldehyde or ketone, are compounds which produce them on hydrolysis. So which is very clear that if you take any kind of the carbohydrate, there one functional group that must be present, either which is to be an aldehyde or which is to be a ketone group, right? So if you see the classification, so this classification is based on the reducing and non-reducing properties of disaccharide, which is very important. So what do you mean by reducing disaccharides? Reducing disaccharides are nothing but there will be a free aldehyde or ketone group. So generally we call them as the disaccharides which will have the free functional group, we call them as reduced disaccharides, right? So second classification is nothing but non-reducing disaccharides. So here, this is completely opposite to the first one. What do you mean by non-reducing disaccharide? Non-reducing disaccharide means where the functional groups are not free. They are involved in the formation of glycosidic bond. So those particular disaccharides, we call them as non-reducing disaccharides. So you just see here the right side table where I've given a few examples, right? But suppose if you take the reducing sugars are glucose, fructose, lactose, maltose, galactose, right? Here, the glucose, fructose, and galactose, these three are comes under monosaccharide, and exclusive to the disaccharides are lactose and maltose. It's clear. Then, The second category example is non-reducing sugar. One very famous example that is called sucrose. Sucrose is a disaccharide, and we will learn into the disaccharide structures and how it is to be non-reducing sugar and what type of the different tests that we will employ to identify whether that particular sugar will be reduced or non-reduced. Right? It's clear. So simple one. Reducing disaccharides are reducing disaccharides are nothing but where the functional groups will be free. So there is no involvement of these functional groups in the glycosidic bond. Non-reducing means the involvement of the functional groups in the glycosidic bond. So there is no free functional groups. So we call them as a non-reducing disaccharides, right? So here I am going to discuss few of the major examples that are related with the disaccharides, right? Here first I have taken with the sucrose, right? If you see the previous slide, sucrose comes to the example of non-reducing disaccharide, right? So here we will see the sucrose. So obviously sucrose is a disaccharide. So this sucrose disaccharide will be made up of two monosaccharide subunits. One is we call them as an alpha D glucose, and second thing we call them as a beta D fructose. So you don't bother about what is alpha, what is D, what is beta, what is D. You just go back to my previous classes, you just understand what is alpha, what is beta, and what is D, right? So here the sucrose is having the two monosaccharide subunit. One we call them as an alpha D glucose, second thing we call them as a beta D fructose. It's clear? So it is glucose and fructose combination will make the sucrose. Then if you see the next property, so where exactly the glycosidic bond can be present? So how do we write the glycosidic bond, which is very simple. So here the glycosidic bond we represent as the first glucose alpha 1 to beta 2, right? What do you mean by alpha 1? That is nothing but the glucose, C1 position of the glucose and C2 position of the fructose will be involving for the bond formation. You just remember this. The bond formation always alpha 1 to beta 2. This is the way we will write it in the glycosidic bond, right? Then one more important property is, then what do you mean by these ozone reactions? That I will discuss in the next slides, right? It can't form the ozone reactions, or it can't be participate in the ozone reactions. What do you mean by ozone and why it is to be participating? That we will discuss in coming slides, right? You just see here, this is called Fischer formula, right? So the Fischer formula, you just remember that this is to be fructose. Why I am saying fructose? Here, the functional group will be the ketone. As I explained that fructose is nothing but an haldose. Haldose is nothing but six carbons, but the functional group will be the ketone. But if you take the first one, this is glucose, the functional group will be the carbohydrate, aldehyde, right? So here the first carbon, right, where I have represented here, the anomeric carbon atom of glucose 1 is make the bond with the anomeric carbon atom of fructose 2. So you just remember this. You just see this one. This is called fructose. This is called glucose. So here the second group, nothing but this is same. This is the functional group of ketone. Here the first group, this is nothing but the functional group of glucose. So both the functional groups are involved to form the glycosidic bond. So this type of reactions we call them as a non-reducing disaccharides. Why? Because non-reducing, both the functional groups are involved in the formation of glycosidic bond. So this is structure of the sucrose. So we will write in a formula like this, alpha T glucoside. We will add the sign. So any molecule which is present previous to the glycosidic bond, we add sign. So alpha D glucoside, here 1 to 2, that is the glycosidic bond formation, beta D fructose, right? The sucrose, the official name, we will call it as alpha D glucoside 1 to 2 beta d fructose, right? This is the structure of the sucrose which comes with the non reducing sugar, and we also call them as this is table sugar. What we are using in our cooking purpose, that comes with this sucrose. So second best example for the disaccharide is we call them as a maltose, right? So these maltose we also call them as a beet sugar, right? Most of the beverages industries, they will use the these maltose for making of the wine parts, right? For making of the wines. So here maltose, which is the best example for the reduced disaccharide. Here there are this is also disaccharide. As I'm explaining, disaccharide means two monosaccharide subunit. One is alpha D glucose. Second one is beta D glucose. You just remember here. Here this is two monosaccharide subunits are same. That is glucose and glucose. But their optical orientation will be different. Where alpha D glucose, the first monosaccharide, second one is beta D glucose. All right. So the free aldehyde group present on C1 of the second glucose, which is very important. So here, what is happening? Why we are calling it as a reduced? That I am explaining here. All right. First, suppose if you see this, you can understand. This is the one functional group of this glucose, that is called aldehyde functional group, and one more aldehyde functional group that can be present at the C1, right? So one functional group of the first glucose will be involved in the glycosidic bond formation with the fourth hydroxylic group of the second glucose molecule. So here the second glucose aldehyde group will be free. So this aldehyde group will be participate many reducing reactions, right? That's what this comes with the reduced sugar, right? So this reduced sugar will form the ozone reactions, where it can form the sunflower shaped ozones. So what do you mean by sunflower shaped ozone? So if you want to be make the crystal form, we will get it in a sunflower shape, right? So maltose will make the sunflower shaped ozone reaction. You should remember it, right? This is the example for the reducing disaccharide. One more reducing disaccharide, the example is lactose, right? So lactose, we also call them as a milk sugar, right? So lactose, if you take any kind of the dairy products or dairy related foods, where we will find the abundant amount of lactose. So the common name, we call them as a milk sugar, right? So this is also a disaccharide, which will be made up of two monosaccharide subunit. First one is beta D galactose. Second one is beta D glucose. So first monosaccharide is galactose. Second monosaccharide is glucose. All right. So here, why I am calling it is that reducing, because if you see the structure there, you should understand. So both are galactose and glucose. They are at the C1 position. All right. If you remember this structure, at the C1 position of the glucose, this is the aldehyde group that we call them as a functional group, that will be free, right? Like maltose. So this can be participate many reduced reactions. So that's what here I have written, the free aldehyde group present at the C1 of second glucose. This is very important, right? So the rest of the structure will be same. How we will write it, this structured ring formula that I explained in the previous classes. So you just go through it. So when come to the ozone formation, definitely these can, because this is a reduced disaccharide which can form the ozone, that shape will be the powder puff shape, right? Which is looks like this powder puff shape. Ozone will be formed by the lactose with the reaction of enol hydrogen, that I will explain, right? Which is very clear. Now, so far we discussed about the sucrose, that is a non-reducing sugar, maltose, that is reducing sugar, and lactose, this is also a reducing sugar. So now we are going to find out how this ozone formation will be done, right? This is a very simple reaction, but we should understand for the disaccharides, right? So here, if you take the ozone formation, it's a simple. First two carbons are involved, which is very important. So this is not R, this is one, right? So if you take disaccharide, disaccharide means, so there will be involvement of C1 of one monosaccharide and C2 of other monosaccharide. That anyway, we will see here reactions, right? So you can see here. But suppose this is a glucose, all right? R nothing but the rest of the structure, right? So this two carbons, carbon 1 and carbon 2, will be reacted with the phenyl hydrazine, right? Which I have written here, phenyl hydrazine, that is nothing but an NH3 related compound, all right? This phenyl hydrazine, when it is reacting with the two carbons of the disaccharide, will form the, finally, will there will be an intermediate that we call them as a glucohydrazone. After that, finally, again, one more molecule of phenyl hydrazine that can be utilized, and this can be added to the carbon 1 and carbon 2. We call them as a glucosone. Why we call them as a glucosone? Because the initial compound will be glucose, right? So like this, two molecules of phenyl hydrazine that can be interacted with this first two carbons of the saccharides and finally make the glucosazones and ozazones. We call them as an ozazones. All right. So here, this is what I have written, the involvement of 192 carbons. Then different configuration on these two carbons give the same type of ozazone. This is very important. Why this sentence is very important? For suppose if you see, if you take monosaccharides, the monosaccharides, if there is a difference at the carbon 1 and carbon 2. For suppose there is a difference between carbon 1 and carbon 2, that is nothing but will form the same kind of the ozone. Why? Because if there is a change in 1, 2, that will not make any sense, because both these two carbons are involved in the formation of ozone reactions. So that's what we call them as differ in a configuration on these two carbons will give the same type of ozone reactions, right? That you should remember. Best example I have given here, you just see here, glucose, fructose and monose. These glucose, fructose, monose, these are the monosaccharides. If you see this structure only, there is a difference between two compounds, right? At the first two carbons. So that's what even the previous lesson, I taught about the epimers. So where glucose and mannose are C2 epimers. So there is a difference at the only carbon 2, right? So carbon 1, carbon 2, if there is no difference, definitely they will form the same kind of the ozazones, because of two molecule of phenyl hydrazine will be interacted with these first two carbons of the saccharides, monosaccharides. So all these three things will form the ozone. That shape looks needle shape, right? If you take their crystals and you just observe it, that we will see, or we will compare with the needle shape, right? So like that, even the maltose definitely, which is a reducing sugar, which I am explained there. So definitely, which will the previous slide which I explained, where it is to be important, the reducing nature. And you can see this can form the sunflower shape, right? Sunflower shaped ozone formation. If you take the lactose, this is also a reducing sugar, and we see the ozone shape is powder puff shape. And one more important point is here, if you take the sucrose does not form any kind of the ozones, because there is no reducing group that can be present, which is important for the formation of ozone reactions. Next, coming to the reducing reactions. So what are the different kinds of the tests we will employ for the understanding of whether that particular saccharide is reducing in nature or non-reducing in nature, right? There are three important tests that can be employed for understanding of the or differentiating between reducing and non-reducing saccharides. Here, one thing, the names is like this. One is Benedict test, second is Fehling's test, third one is Barfoot test, right? These are the three tests which will be employed for the understanding of reducing and non-reducing nature of saccharides, right? Benedict test, Fehling's test, and Barfoot test, right? Then what is the major reactions that can be common for this all the test? So how we can be identified? If you are taking the reduced disaccharide, for suppose reducing disaccharide mean if you take the maltose, so what is the reaction it will be taking place? So if you take the reduced saccharide here, right, so this can form the enediol, that is to be intermediate formation of that structure, and this copper sulfate, where the these cupric ions will be formed, these cupric ions will be interacted with this enediol formation and will be that can be reduced and will form the cuprous ions, right? So finally these cuprous ions will be interacted, will be taken with the hydroxyl group and finally will form the cupric oxide, right? You can see cuprous oxide and cupric oxide. So this can form the cuprous oxide. So this is the major test that can be employed for the reducing disaccharides. You just see here, the sugars reduce cupric ions, that is nothing but Cu plus, of copper sulfate to cuprous ions, that is nothing but Cu plus, which form a yellow precipitate of cuprous oxide. Sometimes which is to be yellow precipitate, or sometimes which is to be a red precipitate of cuprous oxide. This is how the reducing saccharides which will be involved for the different kinds of the test. So coming to the final slide of this disaccharide, so what are the advantages, right? So these advantages are very important, and where do we use this disaccharide? I have given a common advantages where we will use these disaccharides, right? If you take the sucrose, all right, sucrose can be used in these following things. But suppose sucrose can be present in many kind of the fruits, right? Example, I have given here apple, watermelon, mango, and banana. This can also be present on vegetables like carrots and beets and corn and even tomatoes also. Then there is a commercial use of this sucrose. That's what we call them as, which is in commerce or which is related with an industry, right? The sucrose can also be used for the candies preparation. Candies preparation is nothing but many kind of the chocolate preparation where they will use the sucrose, right? Not only that, even many of the soft drinks. So all these soft drinks, they can be used by the sucrose for giving the sweet taste to the particular drinks. This is the advantage of sucrose. If you take the maltose advantage, maltose can also be present in the sweet potatoes, right? This can be used in a bread, pizza, cakes, and cookies. So these are all commercial values. The baked product, this baked product, they will use the maltose for the preparation of them, right? If you take the third one, that is the lactose. Definitely the lactose, the common source of lactose will be milk, right? But this can also be present in the making of yogurt, ice creams, and cheese, right? This is all related with the dairies. So you should remember that. So these are the various applications that are involvement of these disaccharide subunits, right? So which is very clear, right? So I think this is enough. So I mostly discussed about very important points, are very important structures that are related with the disaccharides, right? Now you should note down the take-home points. Take-home points are first point is Disaccharides are nothing but two monosaccharide subunits will be connected with a glycosidic bond, all right? These two monosaccharides are maybe similar or may not be. That is the first point. And second point, you should be remember what are the reducing and non-reducing disaccharides. So reducing disaccharides are nothing but where one functional group or any of the functional group, either which is aldehyde or ketone, if that is to be free in that particular structure, we call them as that is a reducing disaccharide. Example is maltose and lactose. So non-reducing saccharide means if there is no free functional group that can be existing in that particular disaccharide, we call them as a non-reducing sugar or non-reducing disaccharide. Example is sucrose or sugar, right? That is the second point. And third point, which is very important, means how the ozone formation will be involved these disaccharides, right? So ozone formation, which is a simple reaction that can be important with the help of the phenyl hydrazine. So where you should remember that if any saccharide, that is whether monosaccharide or disaccharide, exclusive this towards monosaccharide, if first two carbons, there is a change in the first two carbons, there is no change in the ozone formation. If the structural change can be present in carbon 1 and carbon 2, even though there is a change at 1, 2, but they will form the same kind of ozone because two molecules of phenyl hydrazine that can be attached to the C1 and C2. That you should remember. And the last one is to be an advantages, right? There will be many advantages, right? As I'm explained here. So these are all having the commercial use, right? So then tomorrow, the next class, we are going to discuss about the polysaccharides and their advantages and their structures.